was reading the Daily Word, which I occasionally read. That's a story of my mother giving that to me. But and one of the things was, I create my life one moment at a time, was the quote for today. As a physician, one of my passions in medicine is really to know the patient's story and to learn as much about it without even speaking to the patient. In dermatology, we're actually trained to look at the observation first and then the subjective. So in medicine, we usually do the subjective and then the objective. But in derm, we look at the objective, at the we observe first. And there you can see so much from just observing a patient, their story, their diagnosis. We look for skin signs of systemic diseases, and it is very, very helpful. A story, just to share, because we're all sharing stories, but on Sunday, after we left the Phillips, I had to go to the hospital for a consult. Yes, dermatologists do go to the hospital for emergency consults. But as I walked, I drove up to the hospital, and there were fire engines, and you know, you couldn't tell if it was like maybe just a drill. And I went in, and I'm headed to the ICU, and I see one of our administrators. Now, as rare it is to see a dermatologist at the hospital on a Sunday, you rarely see an administrator there too. So the and this is someone that I know fairly well, and the look on her face was just, it was like something really big had just happened. And it was, the whole story was told there. And then I found out about, you know, the incident that had happened at the hospital center. It's so important to train our healthcare providers to really make accurate diagnosis using the skin and to decide on systemic diseases that patients may have. So we've been very active in creating a curriculum in visual acuity and in diagnosis to help use all of the senses, except taste, of course, to make diagnoses.
I'm Annette Polan. Thank you so much for inviting me to be here. I'm an artist with a specialty in portraiture. I am not Marilyn Monroe from any angle, but I am from Appalachia originally. I taught artists for over 30 years at the Corcoran in Washington, and I saw over and over that creativity and visual literacy were skills that can be learned. I also saw the power of art firsthand when I organized Faces of the Fallen. It was 250 artists from all around the country who did portraits of the first 1,327 American servicemen killed in Afghanistan and Iraq. The chairman of the Joint Chiefs said, "Art here has accomplished what words can never say." Lynn and I have a story together that actually began in China, going down the Yangtze River. We discovered that even though we come from very different backgrounds, we have a similar way of seeing. We have a similar way of looking at people, analyzing them to get their stories and their emotions. We're here today together because we both feel very strongly that the medical profession can learn something from the world of art. Lynn and I founded Capital Artports, which is a tool for asymmetric thinking and visual experimentation to help actually change your worldview through visual literacy. I have discovered it will increase your observational skills and increase your communication skills.
Our hypothesis in training visual literacy in the medical will impact healthcare by improving diagnostic accuracy, improve patient and employee safety. There will be decrease in medical errors, and the bottom line is that there will be a decrease in healthcare costs. It was interesting, Mark's comment about developing intellectual capital. I think this tool could definitely be used to develop the intellectual curiosity, as was demonstrated on Sunday. The connection of the world of art and the world of medicine will be beneficial in many ways. We're looking to enhance, it's one thing that art does, it enhances your visual acumen and allows you to really look at more differences in people and develop some cultural competency, which we do need in our area. Art will allow you to analyze and solve problems. It will teach you to listen to your gut, as you should be doing with patients also. And you combine that with evidence-based medicine, and you come up with a cure and a way of truly helping patients. Art and medicine, or art particularly, will help with physician burnout and the stress, just the professional fatigue and stress that we're experiencing every day. The visual makes you stay in the present and deal with what is in front of you right now. And that's going to be very important. And then everybody's been talking. As people were talking, I said, oh, they're stealing our thunder just a little bit. But I think this is all going together. But looking at art, I think the experience Sunday allowed us to be in the most safe environment. And you were allowed to express opinions that other people might not agree with you. They might really think it was just completely off the wall. Didn't involve a patient's life, but it did allow you to feel and create a very safe space to fail in. And then, of course, there was a cooperation of team building also. Oh, and encourage different perspectives. The one thing we learned with this workshop, too, is that people have very different perspectives. Your background and where you grew up and your cultures is very important in terms of how you view art and how you view your patients.
Our recorded history actually begins with pictures. This is something from Chauvet. These cave drawings are 30,000 years old, more or less, and are some of the very earliest examples of visual literacy. They tell a story. 30,000 years ago, man drew what he couldn't write. Today, our culture has become so predominantly visual that almost all, at least 50% of the information we gather comes from visual images. It's transmitted through your cell phone, through your computer. These charts, pictures, maps, texts are all mingling on screen so that it's really hard to tell where the visual ends and the verbal begins. I just want to say, you know, I work so traditionally in a way that hasn't changed since the 15th century. People come to my studio, they sit. It takes, I don't know, 6 to 9 months to do a portrait. It's like as low tech as you can get. There's brush, there's canvas. But when I had heard somebody from Silicon Valley here today, this design thinking is sort of my ideal. I just admire how they're letting the visual lead and it actually improve our lives.
The ancients also clearly understood that medicine and art were connected. Apollo, the son of Zeus, was one of the most important and complex Olympian deities. He is recognized as a god of light and the sun, truth and prophecy, healing, music, poetry, and more. He's kind of like Mark Smith, if you want to use your imagination.
Apollo.
Right. Just look closely and you'll see the resemblance.
Who's laughing? This image is a blackboard drawing by an artist named Joseph Beuys, a really famous mid-20th century German artist. And it actually provides a blueprint of an artist's mind. Now, whether you can read it or not, the first thing you notice is there's nothing linear about it. It's all over the place. Beuys has used drawings not to document or describe, but as a vehicle to transfer thought from the invisible to the visible.
Many of the best medical schools in the country have made an effort to reintroduce the arts and humanities into training physicians. And this goes further back than just the medical schools, but in elementary schools and high schools, too. However, we don't have too much of that. The doctors don't get much of that after you graduate from medical school, the doctors now, and the ones who have graduated a while ago when it was never in the medical schools really get none of that, except this conference today I think will count, so we can put that down. But besides from this conference, how many of you have had physicians here have had a CME, let's say, in the arts and humanities? Anyone? Yes. Oh, well, you don't count, Maggie. You can put up two hands there. And the common things is, you know, why should we, who has the time, that kind of thing. So we'll get to that a little bit, and I think the session Sunday helped with that. Do you want to go on with the...
This is where we took about 20, or met, rather, 20 of your colleagues on Sunday. Can you just stand up and...
Yeah.
You were brave giving up your, thank you, those of you who joined us.
There are more, let's see, big hand, because they were. We were together for 4 hours, you know.
We selected the Phillips because it really is a small, intimate environment, and it houses really one of the best collections of modern art in the world. There's a little connection between art and medicine at the Phillips. It was actually founded by Duncan Phillips as a memorial to his father and his brother, who died during the great influenza pandemic in 1917-1918.
So Duncan Phillips really had a great way of expressing himself and the importance of art to him with the loss of his family. "Sorrow all but overwhelmed me," he later wrote. "Then I turned to my love of painting for the will to live." Art really helps people sustain healthy lives. It is much more than decoration. It's art is alive. You experience, you feel. It doesn't breathe or move, but it moves you. Art is a tool that helps us grasp the diversity of the world and really to understand many different kinds of cultures, because every culture has an art, and every culture tells their stories through art and its history, and explore emotional capacities that we have as we navigate in the world. Our patients do this for us also. We can recognize their different cultures, we hear their different stories with every patient that we have.
So We had about 20 people at the Phillips, and we divided them into four small teams. Each team was assigned one painting and then required to spend 20 minutes studying this one painting and come up with a 5-minute presentation that they would give to the group as a whole. They were handed a little sheet that had a small black and white reproduction of the work they were going to study and gave a location, but it didn't identify the painting by artist or even title, which, I mean, for somebody in the world of art, this was a hard thing for me to...
This was actually something that we really discussed, because in dermatology, when we have our grand rounds, you do not know the diagnosis, and you have to make the diagnosis. So I see giving a title to the painting the same as making a diagnosis of a patient, and bringing together all the parts of the painting to make a diagnosis. So it was, the two met.
So on this little handout were three very basic generic questions. First of all, we wanted people to allow themselves to feel. We asked them, what are your immediate gut reactions to this work of art? And then they were just supposed to write that down to share later. Then we wanted them to describe this painting. What can you tell about it that, what can you tell about it? That when was it painted? What is it describing? And then what is the story that's going on with this painting?
So you are going to now have a chance to participate in this and just have a little experience of a taste of the workshop on Sunday. If you notice on your tables, you're going to work together as a group at your table. There's an envelope, a sealed envelope.
It says, and do not open.
Envelope number one. Are there five? Oh, okay, the paintings are in envelope number one at every table, okay. And you will have one of the four pictures that we will that we saw at the museum. You can now open the envelope, and you will spend the next 2 minutes studying the painting individually, okay, looking at it, going through these questions. We'll leave them up for you, looking at your reactions. And then you will talk together for 5 minutes and decide among yourselves and even choose a spokesperson who might want to speak for the group as we ask questions. And we will take a total of 7 minutes of your undivided attention being in the present. And we could start
now.
Okay, so 2 minutes, and then we'll show you when to change.
Well, that was great to hear all of this discussion. Just remember, you only had 5 minutes to talk, and your colleagues on Sunday had 20. I mean, we were there for 2.5 hours. And the time, for me, I don't know about the others, flew.
Actually, using this time period, though, we figured that it is about the same amount of time that we spend with patients. 7 minutes is all we get in the current system for most of us to really have face-to-face time with the patient. So we wanted you to experience that. We want to also, maybe some point see if the people who spent more time, did they see more? The people who spent less time, did they see more? You know, we'll at some point maybe do a study about that. You know.
Okay. Oh, we forgot to put us.
Oh, this was a great
apologies
slide.
To Picasso.
Yeah.
Creative and innovative. Okay, who of you had this painting? Which tables?
No.
Oh, raise up high so we can.
So I think I'll start off the discussion about these paintings first of all, this is the Repentant St. Peter by El Greco, who was Greek but actually lived and worked in Spain. He painted a later part of the 16th century. So I think since we ask you to react first emotionally, I'm going to just go over some of the reactions that came up on Sunday. And then those of you who were there on Sunday, if you have anything to add, I'd love it. Your presentations can be as creative as you want to make. You can burst out into song. You can create a little play. You can. That didn't happen. The list of emotions that came up with this painting were longing, sorrow, compassion, guilt, grief, and anguish. Actually, somebody who was there, who's a nurse, said, I felt bad. I wanted to help him, to listen to him, to give him compassion. I thought, wow, El Greco has a lot of power. Somebody else said, he shows a sense of failure, but there's a future in the midst of his failure, and that in part is symbolized by the use of gold in the painting. Somebody else empathized with him. As the founder of the Catholic Church, he's worried about what he's gotten himself into. There were, each painting that we looked at, the discussion just went on and on. There were lots and lots of questions about this story. He was immediately identified as St. Peter by the keys in his girdle. I think you can't really fully understand El Greco and this painting without knowing a little about Philip II and the Catholic Church in Spain at this time. This is the moment of the Inquisition, where the church is all about sin and repentance and denial of the flesh. There's a lot here. And if you notice, one way of looking at St. Peter and his flesh is painted the exact same way that the drapery is painted. Lynn, a doctor, has another way of looking at it.
Yeah, I actually looked at, first of all, the musculature is a little abnormal distribution, and the bones are in a wrists are a little different. They are odd, but it looks as though he has some type of lipodystrophy where they're lumps of fat, and then he has that are lipomas, not true body fat, but and he has facial wasting, and temporal wasting also. I learned from Annette that he did have a myopia, and it sometimes you'll the artists will see very elongated, will paint elongated pictures when you have a myopia. So it was just these the medical things. He also is supposed to, you know, he's older, gray hair, but doesn't have a true male pattern baldness. He's got full head of hair, very well cropped and everything too, yeah.
So the most heated part of this discussion was how many figures are in this painting?
Yeah. Let's show a show of hands. How many say one figure? One figure.
One figure.
One, okay, one character, one figure. Two. Three. Three, okay. Four. Five different
five
characters, okay. Six, going once, going twice.
Well, the great thing about art is there are no wrong answers.
Yeah. I wonder, though, the people who saw six, would you be willing to show us the characters?
Mark, is it okay if we drag
this? We'll go a little bit over.
A little bit, okay. To get all the pictures, yeah, okay. Okay,
most historians think there are two figures. There's St. Peter and there's the Magdalene. And that might be the reason that Duncan Phillips actually bought this painting. Look to the right of St. Peter, that light area. That's the Magdalene coming forward in this blaze of light. She's physically handled very differently. The painting is very loose. She's got these diaphanous robes on. She's just vague, where he's very detailed, but by putting her right next to St. Peter, I think that you can assume that El Greco is saying this is the forecoming of the resurrection and the glory of God. So you have death and rebirth in the same painting. I mean, you can't look at any of these paintings without putting them in context of the Catholic Church.
Okay, let's go to the...
So we're not going to ask any questions about this, sorry.
Yeah. Did anyone have any quick thing to add that they saw? Okay, let's go to the next question. Next.
So this painting is called Hide and Seek. It's by William Merritt Chase, painted in 1888. He's an American painter who studied in Germany, actually, but has a lot of the freedom of the Impressionist painting, is considered an American Impressionist. People on Sunday expressed a sense of mystery, anticipation, curiosity. There was a lot of talk about the story here. These two very well-dressed young girls, probably sisters, probably playing a game in a lavish interior. However, it's strangely empty, strangely bare. And a curious thing, he was greatly influenced by the Japanese and also photography. This painting, the way he's cropped the figures, you don't see this earlier on. The figure in the foreground is painted very sharply. Figures in the background are soft focus, so this whole camera depth of field. This is not an art history lesson.
I guess. What did anyone want to share? One of the tables. Who had this painting?
Yeah, we're gonna. Okay.
I will say that somebody who's here today came and said, you know, I work in cardiac surgery, and I'm used to everything being black and white, but hearing different opinions is really refreshing. I love that I'm getting to the greener side of humanity. So maybe that's...
This is great. I'd love to...
It's lunchtime.
It is lunchtime. We've got two more.
Yes.
And, you know, there are no wrong answers. This is the greener side of humanity. I had... Our table had one of the other ones. I'm eager to hear about it.
Well, we'll show that everyone...
But we'll come on up if you want to talk. But I want to stick to what we said, which was... Start on time and end on time.
Right.
So we're going to go to lunch. Lunch is upstairs. Out this door, out that door. Take the stairs up. It's in the ballroom upstairs. And then we're going to gather back here in at 1:25. Thank you.